grant us grace to serve in holiness the one who died for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, look with loving mercy on your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and to be given over to the hands of sinners and suffer death on the cross, who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Look to Jesus, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?" Keep going. So the soldiers, their officers, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus. First, they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die than two people.
Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, "You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing round it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Then the Annas set him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, "You are not also one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him? Again, Peter denied it, and at the moment the cock crowed.
Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and be able to eat Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said to him, "Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law." The Jews replied, "We are not permitted to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is the truth?" After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, "I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. You want me to release you, the king of the Jews?" They shouted in reply, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a bandit.
you know that I find no case against him. So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. And Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Oh, take him yourselves and crucify him. I have no case against him." Then the Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he has claimed to be the Son of God." Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and the power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you're no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the stone pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here's your king." And they cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." And then he handed him over to them to be crucified. Thank you. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus was his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there, so they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that what he tells is the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled: "None of his bones shall be broken." And again, in another passage of scripture, it says, "They will look on the one whom they have pierced."
Thank you.
"It is finished." That's how John's gospel records the closing moments in the earthly life of Jesus Christ. Each of the gospel writers tells it a little bit differently. Did you know that? Luke quotes Jesus as saying, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit," and then he died. In Matthew, Jesus cries out twice, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And then he died. In Mark, Jesus utters a loud cry and breathes his last. But I like John's version best. "It is finished," and then he died. Now, none of these descriptions are inaccurate. When fear grips us and when sorrow overtakes us, each of us notices and remembers different things. But John makes a theological statement when he recalls Jesus' last words. "It is finished." What is it? It is the plan God created to bring humankind back into a secure relationship with the Father once again. It is the life project of Jesus to allow himself to be sacrificed as the Lamb. It is the end of the most horrific week in human history, when loyalty and love was transcended by mob rule and jealous hatred. It explicitly is the work of salvation. It was finished on Good Friday. In truth, it cannot be completely and totally complete until you and I hear it, see it, grasp it, and own it as our own. And that's why this final stone is the most painful of all. May God grant us the faith and the courage to ponder Good Friday and the day it became God's gracious act. Now, there are so many curious things to note in this tragic story of Jesus' death. The trial before Pilate was really a kangaroo court because so many Roman and Jewish laws were broken in the process. For instance, the trial happened at night, while courts of justice were supposed to occur in the light of day. Jesus was convicted by a single judge, while typically a jury of three was required. The deliberations were supposed to go on for another day. It was society's way of sleeping on it. Before a man was sentenced to be executed, none of this was followed. But don't be too hard on the Roman and Jewish leaders of the day. It was supposed to be this way. Ironically, if Jesus was to be executed for violating Jewish law, he would not have been crucified. He would have been stoned to death. That was the Jews' way. Convicted criminals were brought to a pit at the edge of the city, pushed down the hill, and then stones would be hurled at them until they stopped moving. In truth, this was a more humane practice since death came so quickly. The Roman practice was much slower, much more painful, and much more hideous. When a man was crucified, he was first stripped of his clothing and beaten. A cat of nine tails, a whip of leather with sharp pieces of glass or stone at the end of it, was used across the back. 39 lashes were administered because it was commonly thought that 40 lashes would kill a man. They wanted him to be near dead so they could watch him die from the cross. Then his naked body was laid across a timber on the was ensured by the thrust of a soldier's spear into his side. When it was obvious that Jesus was dead, a Pharisee by the name of Joseph, a wealthy man, received permission from Pilate to take Jesus' body down to the cross on Friday night. The Jewish Sabbath was about to begin. If it were not done on Friday, we'd have to wait till Saturday night. Joseph wanted to remove Jesus' body respectfully as soon as possible. Scripture then says that Joseph brought Jesus' body and placed it in his own burial tomb. A large stone was rolled in front of the entrance of the grave, not only to close the grave respectfully, but also to prevent grave robbers from stealing Jesus' body and falsely proclaiming a resurrection. The stone, while we may picture it today as a large round boulder, was rather a large disc set into a groove at the entrance of the grave and then rolled into place after the body was inside. The resounding sound of its closing echoed the finality of Jesus' death. It was finished indeed. That is the historical evidence of Jesus' death. Though it's graphically ugly, we can keep it at a distance, and it's not so difficult for us to consider. But the death of Jesus Christ was never intended to be taken historically or in a detached manner. It must be taken personally. And this is where Good Friday takes us, to the foot of the cross, to a grave loudly closed, to a day without hope. All the stones that you and I have laid at the foot of the cross this Lenten season have finally taken their toll. All the greed, all the hatred, all the vulgarity, all the selfishness, all the violence, all the unfaithfulness, they have not only covered the base of the cross, but they have littered our lives. And that's not even the sum total of our stones. We each have secret sins known only to us and God. God invites us to lay them at the cross as well. He takes them unto himself. The entire load of enormous weight of them all, pressing down on his body as he hangs on that cross. Our stones, our sins, his cross, and now it's finished. The final stone is the one which is rolled to the entrance of Jesus' grave, a final barrier, if you will, between us and the one who loves us so much. When the final stone was rolled into place, it gave tangible expression of our sins. The sum of them is so enormous, they block us from God. They keep us from the kindest, loveliest man who ever lived. And try as hard as we may, we cannot remove the stones ourselves. Not the stones at the base of the cross. Not the stone that seals Jesus' grave. Talk about feeling helpless. And that's exactly what we are. A helpless, hopeless people, partners in Good Friday crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Today, we hold the final stone. This one's different from all the other stones. This one's marked with a black cross. It's different in that we won't be leaving this in the sanctuary. We take this one home with us. We want this to be a reminder of the stones that keep us from loving God. Let it be a reminder of the stone that stands between us and a Savior. Here and give each and every one of you a stone like this and ask you to carry it through the sorrow of tomorrow. Carry it with you through the anguish of Sunday's darkness. Perhaps bring it with you to worship on Easter morning so that we can never forget the final stone that actually changed the course of human history. It is finished indeed. Thank you. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for Elizabeth and Kurt, our bishops, for our pastor and for all pastors, for all servants of the church, and for all the people of God. Almighty and eternal God, your Spirit guides the church and makes it holy. Strengthen and uphold our bishops, pastors, and other ministers and lay leaders. Keep them in health and safety for the good of the church. And help each of us in our various vocations to do faithfully the work to which you've called us. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and eternal God, you continue to bless the church. Increase the faith and understanding of those who prepare for baptism. Give them new birth as your children, and keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and eternal God, you give your church unity. Look with favor on all who follow Jesus, your Son. Make all the baptized one in the fullness of faith and keep us united in the fellowship of love. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and eternal God, long ago you gave your promise to Abraham and your teaching to Moses. Hear our prayers that the people you called and elected as your own may receive the fulfillment of the covenant's promises. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Almighty and eternal God, gather into your embrace all those who call out to you under different names. Bring an end to interreligious strife. Make us more faithful witnesses of the love made known to us in your Son. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Almighty and eternal God, you created humanity so that all may long to know you and find peace in you. Grant that all may recognize the signs of your love and grace in the world and in the lives of Christians, and gladly acknowledge you as the one true God. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty and eternal God, you are the creator of a magnificent universe. Hold all the worlds in the arms of your care and bring all things to fulfillment in you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty and eternal God, you are the champion of the poor and oppressed. In your goodness, give wisdom to those in authority, so that all people may enjoy justice, freedom, peace, and a share in the goodness of your creation. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty and eternal God, you give strength to the weary and new courage to those who have lost heart. Heal the sick, comfort the dying, give safety to travelers, free those unjustly deprived of liberty, deliver your world from falsehood, hunger, and disease. We ask you to control and be with those people with COVID-19. We ask you to help all of us get a hold on this disease and put an end to it. Hear the prayers of all who call on you in any trouble, that they may have the joy of receiving your help in their need. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Finally, let us pray for all those things.
By your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.